The Monitor Channel is proud to present Mort Sahl Live. Ladies and gentlemen, Mort Sahl.
Thanks for coming. This is the Orange County Register. This is the... the big news in the Orange County Register is President Bush is going to Russia. He's got a new plan. Is President Bush is going to Russia to stay? No. No such luck. He's going over there to loan them money so that they can buy our grain. And, well, we don't care. It's other people's money. So, okay. Now, I'll be back to the newspaper in a minute. We also are putting a literary section in the show tonight. I want to tell you a little bit about what you're in for. And we read the greatest books. Here's Oliver North's book, which I'm halfway through. The ad for this in the Orange County Register today is a full page of Oliver North, and it says, "For the first time, I can tell the truth." As opposed to when he's under oath, of course. So, and then we have a biography here, which is rather moving, by Dan Rather, called I Remember, and of course the autobiography of Ronald Reagan called I Don't Remember. So we know all about all this. Now, The other point I wanted to make here is that we're going to talk about movies tonight because we're in the backyard of the Phantom movie business. This is the worst business in 21 years they have now, and they're all trying desperately to find out why. The people that make movies, they have focus groups like yourselves that come in and vote on what the end of a movie should be at a preview, you know, that kind of stuff, and probably the worst use of democracy in our time. So that's right. So that's something to think about. And then, of course, do you go to the movies? I don't know. I don't go to the movies. I would like to go to the movies, but I can't find any movies that get to me. In the entertainment page here of the Register here, you see the various movies. There's one about drug dealers, and then there's one over here about cannibalism, and there's one about bestiality, and one about child molesting. So, in other words, something for the whole family, if you care to go to the mall. Anyway, now let's talk about something serious. We're kidding about President Bush before. There's some problems with the economy. And somebody said there was an armored car robbery in Los Angeles a couple of days ago, and the thieves got away with $4.5 million, the street value of which is $129,000. So, what else? So let me tell you why I'm doing this show. This is our second show. We did the first one at the Eastern Cable Convention in Atlantic City a month ago. I was a part of the Iran-Contra scandal. I guess some of you read about that in the papers. And I have 200 hours more of community service to do. You all remember this, don't you? You remember about that? Oliver North, and you remember it all started when President Reagan wanted to get the hostages out. And the way in which we did this was by Oliver North approaching moderate Iranians who have been defined since as Iranians who have run out of ammunition. You all remember that? Okay. Now, getting back to the economy, I don't want to distract you. President Bush has said that we should pump prime the economy. You know, he said, if I were an American citizen, I'd go out and I'd buy a house. I would buy a house or buy a car. Rob a bank. So, okay. The program tonight is political. It's also about movies, as I said, and it's also about women, because I think there's an ongoing war between men and women. You know, it was Stendhal who pointed out that the grand ambition of women, at least in his time, was to inspire love. Obviously, Stendhal was not an American, and unlucky guy. And I'm kind of old-fashioned. I guess a lot of you know that, seen me before. I tend to believe that men's business is power and women's business is love. The problem being, of course, that women have gone out of business. That's part of the problem. So, okay, now what else? What other news today? Amnesty International came out against marriage, and you know what Jackie Gleason said to me once? He said a woman came up to him once and she said, "You men, you take away the golden years of our girlhood and you make us raise your children, cook your meals, and clean your floors." And Gleason said, "That's right, but you women, you get even with us, you marry us." So interesting, huh? So, yeah. So I like to, you know, to make these things by attribution so you don't think I think them. So, okay. Now, before we sum this up, I just want to say to you now, theory is necessary if you're going to enjoy the program tonight, especially when we get to the news in the next segment. You've got to understand and appreciate our presidents. We have ex-presidents up to our ears now. We've got five of them running around. And people, the Democrats are fond of saying to me, I don't know if they say this to you, they say this to you, they say, "I never appreciated Jimmy Carter. Look what he's done. Look what he's done with his life. Reagan's going to Japan and getting $2 million for cutting a ribbon in front of a store. And Jimmy Carter is has his own television program, This Old House," you know? They say all that. And they say he's a wonderful man. Did you ever think that you'd live long enough in America to judge a president on what he did after he left office? So, well... So before I leave, and I'll have a few words of welcome, I want to say first perfunctory welcome to our Russian guests. We have the head of Moscow Television here, who was also the head of the Moscow newspaper that stayed with President Gorbachev. And, you know, that wasn't a very popular view. That's tremendous courage. You may remember that when Yeltsin was in what they call the White House there, our own Diane Sawyer was in there. And Diane Sawyer saw Yeltsin there with a gun on his hip and two bodyguards and a radio. And she said, "You can't win. There's no way this thing can work. You're doomed." So she didn't show an awful lot of faith. So by default, the Russians had to show faith in their country since the American press. Actually, it's a good thing for Gorbachev that Yeltsin didn't know of the importance of Diane Sawyer. See, if that happened here, you know the power of the press here. You know, I can give you an idea. I've been divorced, and you know, in Los Angeles, I was very happily married. I really loved my wife. And then the Daily Variety came out, the show business Bible, and a columnist named Army Archer said, "Mort Sahl and his wife have had it. It's over." And I called my press agent. I said, "What am I going to do here? This isn't true." My press agent said, "I'd think about that, because this guy's a very powerful journalist." So I said, "But I love her." He said, "Well, just tape her off. See less of her, and it'll be easier." Okay. But Yeltsin, of course, didn't know Diane Sawyer is really important. So he kept Russia together. So it's something for you all to think about. Now, by way of closing, let me remind you of one more true story. That's not bad in 10 minutes, the true stories. We're going to talk about Hollywood tonight and movies. We have a wonderful writer for you here. The screenwriter, Robert Towne, is guesting on the program. The author of Chinatown, a lot of other movies you all admire. And... when we had the writer's strike this year, I was lucky enough to be at the bargaining session. And the writers wouldn't give in. And finally, an attorney arrived to make peace. And he walked in. I won't give his name. And he walked in and he said, "I urge the union, the Writers Guild, to accept everything the studios are offering." And the president of the Writers Guild said, "If I accept their offer, I'll be betraying every one of my principles." And the attorney said, "Sometimes you have to rise above your principles." I'll be right back with the news. Thank you very much. Thank you. we call this section of the show, section two, is the news and review. So I want to, you know, reporting the news to you is like reporting an accident to an eyewitness. But but here we go, okay?
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States, accompanied by the 40th President, the 39th President, the 38th President, and the 37th President.
Don't rub it in. This is the Reagan Library in Simi Valley, second only to the Nixon Library in Yorba Linda, where almost every book is overdue.
And I do believe in equal rights for everyone in this country, even white people.
Former Governor Edwin Edwards, whose own past is tainted by accusations of womanizing and gambling.
I was in New Orleans the night before the election, and Sheriff Lee told me the following story. Buddy Romer, the incumbent governor, the new governor, Governor Edwards, and the governor-elect, and David Duke are in a rowboat, and it springs a big hole in the bottom, and they're obviously going to drown, and God only has one life preserver. And the sheriff said to me, who does he save? I said, who? He said, he lets them all drown and he saves Louisiana. You know, in the state of Minnesota, and you know they have a tremendous tradition up there, the DFL, Democrat Farm Labor Party, and you know, they produced, you know, you're talking about terrific people. Anyway, they put on the ballot at one time, none of the above, below all the people running. And they had to take it off, of course, because they kept winning.
Okay. The latest check on the economy's vital signs show it's still very, very sick.
Let me be the first to say all is not well.
Senators vote today on the confirmation of Robert Gates to head the Central Intelligence Agency.
Now, you know, when Gates came up to be confirmed, Senator Boren, the chairman of the committee, said to him, thank you for coming up here to see us. And Gates said, well, I was following you anyway, Senator. So one other line might be interested in. I worked at a private party for President Bush 2 months ago, and he said to me, I'm not a hard-nosed guy. If anybody's got a suggestion of who I should appoint, you should tell me. So, you know, it's very rare that anybody has asked me to advise him. So he said to me, who do you think I should get to run the CIA? I said, why don't you get the same guy who ran it when you ran it?
Here to be further humiliated by this committee or anyone else.
Now, Judge Thomas, you know, I got to tell you, I'm kind of nonpartisan. I hate to take sides, as you all know, historically, but I don't like to see the United States Senate accused of, as he termed it, a high-tech lynching. He said it's because he's an uppity black man. Now, I may be the only one in the room, but I know Justice Thomas. And I can assure you that it's possible to dislike him for himself. This is the Senate Judiciary Committee. Now notice on the left, you have the Republicans unencumbered by conscience. And on the right, you got the Democrats paralyzed with guilt.
If what you say this man said to you.
Number one hatchet man, Simpson.
Why in God's name would you ever speak to a man like that the rest of your life?
I'm saying that men think in one way and women think.
That's hatchet man number two. Orrin Hatch, okay?
And what a man thinks is sexually harassing may actually be to a woman, but he may not have meant it that way, he may not think it that way. He may be the usual insensitive oafs we generally are as men.
Was there any substance in Ms.
Hatchet man number three, Arlen Specter, he put the stiletto in. Now, how many of you, I know you say to yourself, well, yeah, I saw that about 3 months ago, Mort, what do you want from me? This section of the show we really call the last word, because we feel we can justify repeating this tape to bring you something you may not have considered. Arlen Specter from Pennsylvania was the junior lawyer on the Warren Commission, yes, sitting four seats from Ted Kennedy, who invented the single bullet theory, which maintained, and we don't challenge it, because the official finding of the government, that bullet 399 had entered John Kennedy's back, exited through his chest, paused for a second and a half. Then seeing Governor Connally, goes on, right, and goes through his arm and makes a right turn and goes, all right, and emerges pristine and unscathed on the stretcher at Parkland Hospital. That's the man. So when he said, I know perjury, when he said that about Anita Hill, and I've talked to people that aren't truthful, he was, of course, referring to questioning Jack Ruby, a patriotic nightclub owner, if that's not a contradiction in terms.
They resorted to the meanest and most unfounded cut of all, that this tenured law professor, who testified with such grace and dignity, is delusional.
Now I'm going to talk to you seriously for a minute, if I may. I think history will absolve Ted Kennedy because he's the only one that focused on the case, and of course it's in the congressional record, which lives a long time after the bad taste in our mouth goes away about the transient administrations in this country, which we can always remedy at the ballot box. I suggest to you, and I know how to joke about Ted Kennedy. I'm the guy who said, Warren Beatty said to me, Gary Hart's like Jack Kennedy. And he was recommending him. And he said to me, and Sally Field, who was campaigning for Dukakis once, said to me, we'd like to get a financial contribution from you, Mort. You'd like Dukakis. He's a lot like Jack Kennedy. And I said in utter frustration at this party, and a waiter was in front of me, I said, is there anybody in the Democratic Party that isn't like Jack Kennedy? And the waiter said, yeah, Ted Kennedy. Right? So I know how to make jokes, but what I'm suggesting to you is that this man, who is the third brother to stand unequivocally for the things that the liberals in the audience claim they believe, which are the rights of women, the rights of black people, the rights of Hispanics, children's rights even, maternity leave, all the issues, all the liberals' issues. This is a man who never backed up on him for 30 years in the Senate, and certainly not his brothers. I'm suggesting that this country is not through with the Kennedys. You're like somebody who got mad at your wife and went to a psychiatrist and want to indict her, but your obsession with discussing nothing but her leads the doctor to believe there's unfinished business. I think there's unfinished business with the Kennedys. And I think, not whatever you question about his moral behavior, but I think the level of excellence which his father taught him about public service and his brothers showed him by example is a level to which, in this cynical era, we no longer aspire. So by discrediting him, if you discredit the religion, you don't have to show up on Sunday. You don't have to sing. That's what I'm suggesting. And this is not an illness that's only in the Democratic Party. It's in the Republican Party. The projection of reducing people because we don't want to meet a standard. Example, the happiest marriage I've ever encountered personally is the Reagans. You pick up Kitty Kelly's book, if you're so disposed, and you read that she dallied with Frank Sinatra. The most faithful woman, the woman who loves her husband, might even be considered a traitor to her class in this generation that's so given to divorce. It gets married with a suitcase packed and one foot out the door. That level of non-commitment. That a book would come out and characterize her as amoral when she's totally moral. It's the only way we can deal with people who experience their ideal rather than crusading toward it. I don't ask you to accept that, and it isn't written in stone, but I ask you to consider it. That's the reason I'm on a monitor channel. We're not afraid of ideas. Yeah, one other thing. This, of course, are the peace talks in Madrid.
The Middle East peace conference edged perilously close to failure today.
Syria says Shamir was a terrorist, and here's the proof. Shamir says, take it from me, Syria still is.
There can't be any guarantees. This is the Middle East.
Well, you know what Secretary Baker's referring to. He told me the story himself. A scorpion can't get across a river, and he says to a tortoise, can I ride on your back? A tortoise says, not me, pal. You're going to bite me and we'll both drown. And the scorpion says, what logic would there be? If you're saving me, why would I do that? So the tortoise is talked into it, he's conned into it, and he agrees, and the scorpion gets on his back. They're halfway across the river, and of course the scorpion bites the tortoise, and they start to drown. And as he goes under for the third time, the tortoise says to the scorpion, why would you bite me if I'm saving your life too? And of course the scorpion says, this is the Middle East. I'll be right back to tell you all about the movie. See you in a minute. pretty weird show, huh, so far? I know, it's not like a regular talk show. The music is American jazz, which you never hear in America, but it's honored overseas. Well, you know, it's like Nazareth. Nobody's a hero in his own hometown. And I know, you're surprised to hear somebody quote the scriptures who isn't running for public office. I'm running from public office. Okay, so we're going to talk about movies tonight. I'm tired of politics, too. I agree with you. This is the way movies are made. I want to give you an idea here so that we can prove our premise tonight that nothing succeeds like excess. So, okay, now here's a best-selling book. It's a best-selling book, and this is what the poster would look like if they made it into a movie. It's called The Last Best Chance, and there's a certain suggestion here. Here's a president who looks remarkably like Robert Redford. That's credible, right? And here's the seal of the President of the United States. Here's a map of the Middle East, vaguely. The marketing line, that's what they use to sell the movies, of course, says, it was not just another day at the office. See, so we know this is the kind of book you might pick up if you go to a bookstore. So how does this become a movie? Okay, we'll start off and we'll get our cast of characters here. So the Japanese come over and they buy a studio. And the head of the studio, who at one time was a hairdresser, and he's immediately fired by the Japanese. So let's get him up here. And in order to fire him, you know, you don't want to take away all his dignity. So you say, you let him say to the press, I'm leaving so I can do something more creative. And they give him several $1 million and they let him open an office and they arrange to have the first look at his work. That's a cinema term. The first look at his work. But he hasn't got any work, right? So he calls his agent and he says, what should I do? I've just become an independent producer. So the agent says, you have to buy a book and make it into a movie. So the producer says, well, you know, would you go with me? I've never been to a bookstore alone, you know. So no, not like that. He says, let me look at the New York Times here. He says, the number one book in a fiction list is The Last Best Chance. So fly the writer to Hollywood. So they fly the novelist out to Hollywood. He meets the producer. The producer says, it's a pleasure to meet you. It's a fantastic book. And the writer says, did you read the book and you liked it? And the producer says, a book as great as yours, you don't need to read it. You know? So then he says, now the agent meets with the producer and he says, so you got to get a script. That has to be adapted. So you get a real great writer. They get a guy like Frank Pearson, right? Frank Pearson gets $400,000 here, so we hire him. Now, you've got to attach names to this, or his boss, his new boss, won't think he's a credible producer. So they call Dustin Hoffman, and he says, I'll give you a definite maybe. I may read it, you know? So he's attached to the project now. Now people say, this is beginning to, you know, it's starting to look real now. Got a movie here, a great novel written by Frank Pearson, and we got Dustin Hoffman. So Hoffman is in, but Hoffman looks at this script, and he says, it's good, but it's too political. You know, I'd like it to be more, it's too much about what it's about. He's that kind of guy, Dustin Hoffman. So Hoffman says, I've got to get a rewrite on the picture. Let's get Alvin Sargent to rewrite it. He gets another $400,000. We got him here. So Alvin Sargent is in here. He's going to rewrite the movie. So he's busy rewriting the movie. Nobody has to do anything. They can remain tentative. Now Hoffman is trying to figure it out, and he says, I know what's wrong with the movie. The president has no interior life. He's like a robot. He's a symbol, like a face on a bill. He said he's got to have a wife and a family and some kind of problems at home. So he calls Warren Beatty, whom he trusts, and he says, Warren, what actresses do you respect? What a straight lines, I tell you. So Warren says, I respect Madonna. So Madonna's attached to the project. Have to make her a firm offer of $4 million. Got her on the project now. And it's beginning to look like a movie, except the Japanese are saying, well, wait a minute. You know, this money, we got $13 million here, and nobody knows what script there. What are we talking about here, right? So the producer goes to dinner with Francis Coppola, and he says to him, I got problems. I can't get a commitment from Hoffman. If I don't have Hoffman, I won't have Madonna. And Hoffman doesn't want his script, and I'm not sure he'll want Alvin Sargent's script when it comes in, because they had a fight since he commissioned them to write the script, and they only talked to each other through my office. So he said, you know, these are administrative problems. So Coppola says, I know about trouble, you know? I made Apocalypse Now. I could be, there's a possibility I would come aboard the picture, you know? So he says, if I do, I have to have my own people. So who are you thinking about? He says, I think that Robert Redford is Plastic Man, and I think that Dustin Hoffman is not credible as the president. So the producer says, who's credible? And Coppola says, Al Pacino. Producer says, I don't see Al Pacino as a president of the United States. Coppola says, I've only been on a picture a day. You're already tying my hands. I'm off the picture. Okay, now it's been a year, and the Japanese are looking at the highly vaunted bottom line, and there's no money coming into the studio. So the Japanese say, the problem is that these guys don't know how to do anything except spend money. So they hire a 31-year-old television guy from CBS, and they make him the head of the studio. Oh, we don't know who he is, but, you know, named Jeff, one of those guys. And with a J. And Jeff comes in and he says, hey, wait a minute. Our movie's so different from television. I mean, let's face it, you know? And the thing that sells is comedy. He said, I don't want to see a picture about terrorism, and I don't want to see a picture about hostages, and I don't want to see any political pictures. I don't even vote, and I don't think any of my friends do. So they're now into the second rewrite, of course, with Alvin Sargent. So these guys are really in trouble. So the new head of the studio, Jeff, says, you know, we have a commitment from Eddie Murphy. Still owes us a commitment. We'll put Eddie Murphy into this picture. Producer says, okay, Madonna's gone. Dustin Hoffman has left the project. We'll put Eddie Murphy in. So Eddie Murphy can't play the president. He says, it's not going to be that. It's going to be a comedy. It'll be subliminally about the presidency. We'll make it into a comedy. So they call in the marketing people, and they say, all right, get rid of that, the last best chance for peace. Forget all that. It's going to be Eddie Murphy, crazy guy. And we'll call a picture, So Help Me. So Eddie Murphy has a meeting that day with the coalition of black Muslims and decides that the picture is going to be trouble. He drops out of the picture. That's gone. Picture is no longer called that. The picture is in limbo again, which means his career is in limbo. The producer, now the studio, his bosses are getting nervous. So the producer says, I know what's wrong with this. I tried to make too big a picture. What I've got to do is make a prestige picture and release it in one theater with 57 seats. On Beverly Boulevard, and forget all the pretension. I'll make it a picture that's a critical success. I'll get James Woods. Nobody ever argues with James Woods, you know? And it'll be a small, meaningful picture. But of course, we'll have to change marketing if we do that. We'll have to call the picture, he'll be a guy who works for the president, and his wife is dying. Maybe we can get Julia Roberts to play his wife. She's dying. She gets $7 million, but she might do this because she likes the idea of dying, you know? So we'll get her. And we'll call the picture A Fresh Breeze from the Sea. It'll be a small picture. Okay, so that goes on. They think about that for about a weekend, and then that doesn't work. So now the producer's getting nervous, and he calls up Sylvester Stallone, and they talk on the phone, and he says to Stallone, how did you get your Ferrari in from Belgium without paying duty? That's the kind of things they talk about. And Stallone says, what are you doing now? He says, well, I've been having trouble with this. I'm trying to make this picture off this novel, and I've been having trouble with it. Stallone says, I'd love to hear it all, and I'd like to help you, but I have to go get a haircut. So the producer says, well, I'll cut your hair. Let me come over there. I used to cut, you know. So he goes over to Stallone's house, and Stallone is with his agent. He's with his agent, Ron Meyer, works for Michael Ovitz, and they're sitting there, and they say, aha, so you were frustrated, you couldn't do it, and so forth. So Ron Meyer says, well, you caught us on a very weak day, because I got him $12 million for playing the arm wrestling champion of America, and I got him $20 million for Rocky IV, and I got him $25 million for Rocky V. I would like to establish a new price to show people that this guy can really act. He says to the producer, we'll make you the executive producer. We'll save your picture. He says, Sly will direct it, and Sly will write it. Sly will be in it, and the producer says, does he want to play the president? He said, we weren't thinking of it that way. Sly, what can we do with it? So Stallone says, he ponders, he says, I think what happens is the president is a peripheral character, maybe played by Jason Robards or somebody that everyone respects in Hollywood. And he says, Rocky goes to Libya and he fights the Libyan champion and he wins. He's got the belt on, heavyweight belt. He's leaving the country and Muammar Gaddafi says, I don't want that belt leaving Libya. We waited too long. I'm making Rocky a Libyan citizen with no passport. So the president calls in Rambo and asks him to rescue Rocky. Then that way, Stallone will be playing two roles for which you'll receive $30 million, which is only fair, says the agent. And the picture will now be called Rocky VI, Rambo IV. Right? We'll be right back with Robert Towne. See you in a minute. This is Robert Towne, and I know you greeted with him applause a moment ago, who wrote, among other things, Chinatown and the Two Jakes and Days of Thunder, and Grace Stoke, The Legend of Tarzan of the Apes, for which you eventually gave the credit to your dog, as I understand. Well, and we're just going to, if you don't mind, you can eavesdrop on what we talk about. When we hang out, and what we talk about is the fact that I can't find a movie to go to. That's what I was telling them earlier about. And, you know, if you told anybody what the trouble is, they'll say there isn't enough money or there isn't enough audience or what people want. Is what people want ever the determinant of how they make movies?
I really don't know. I know The most accurate statement I've seen on what movies are about was written by Jack Matthews when he said the thing that nobody is saying is that the movies aren't very good, and they're not very good because we seem to have either lost the ability or the desire to tell a story. And I know every week my friends find it's hard to go see a movie.
Pretty simple, huh? The movies aren't very good. Now, I don't know if the marketing people have looked into that. We want you to review a couple of things with this, because one of the things Bob and I agree on is heroes. We think they're essential. Neither one of us believe what it says in the paper, that there aren't any heroes, but we want you to trace with us, if you look over our shoulder, if you will, for a minute, what happened to heroes? And we chose to start with Jimmy Stewart. And we may freeze this along the way if you have any thoughts, Bob, about this. I want to show you the development of the hero. Development may not be the word. It may be the degeneracy. Okay, here's Jimmy Stewart.
There you are.
That'll close my account.
Your account's still here. That's a loan. Okay.
That's the life of Charles Keating. I'm sorry. Okay, here's Jimmy Stewart and It's a Wonderful Life.
What are you doing? Now you're talking. All right, Miss Davis.
Could I have $17.50?
That's your heart. Of course you can have it. You got 50 cents. Seven.
We're going to make it, George.
Six.
They'll never close this up today.
Five, four, three, two, one. Bingo!
You believe Jimmy Stewart, Bob?
Oh, yeah.
All the time?
Yeah.
Never thought that was corny?
No.
Trust him?
Yes.
Okay. Now, the world keeps beating up Jimmy Stewart, right? Gets tougher after 1939. And we think that the next personification of that hero is Clint Eastwood.
I know what you're thinking. Did he fire six shots or only five? Well, to tell you the truth, in all this excitement, I've kind of lost track myself. But being this is a .44 Magnum, the most powerful handgun in the world, and would blow your head clean off, you've got to ask yourself one question. Do I feel lucky? Well, do you, punk?
Bob is a right-wing cop. There weren't any up until then, were there?
He probably came out of James Bond by way of the anti-hero image. And feeling that it was a dirty job, but somebody had to do it. Somebody
had to
fight the Russians. Somebody had to fight criminals, and any way they could. And that was a new character, that he wasn't going to play by traditional rules, even though he was going to be on the traditional side.
Because the enormity of the job, but it's still traditional side.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Nice bike. Fast, huh?
This is Michael Douglas now. Notice that's the next generation. He's a cop. You can't tell him from a hoodlum, can you? Or am I oversimplifying this?
No, I don't think so.
This is a policeman on his day off.
Ain't you got nothing better to do with your Sundays?
Yeah, I got 50 on Nick, man.
What do you say?
So, as a policeman now, he's indistinguishable. Now, what else can happen to the hero, Sylvester Stallone? Playing the role of Secretary Cheney, Bob. Now, what's happened here? We went from a guy who is a cop and he's got an apartment and he goes to see his kid because he doesn't have custody and all those cliches. What was the quantum jump to this guy? What is he?
Rambo?
Yeah.
I think Rambo was, a kind of wish fulfillment fantasy. I mean, I actually have not seen any Rambo all the way through, but I was told that one of the... Sorry, I can't help
it. And he goes to the movies.
And I do, but I was told by somebody that he says in one of them, do we get to win this time?
Yes.
And I guess it was a wish fulfillment fantasy that what we couldn't do in Vietnam, Sylvester Stallone would do in Rambo, I guess.
So as the country becomes less confrontational and less... It feels more powerless about doing anything to correct the dilemma we're in. Their fantasies are bigger.
Yes.
So the only place we can go from Rambo is maybe past humanity. So you have what, one machine fighting another?
He's superhuman. He's a cyborg who is virtually indestructible. Terminator 1 is a movie I liked. But the point is that the only recourse that we have to deal with a threatening world is somebody who is absolutely inhuman and can win it, overcome anybody.
The Army training films I saw were better than some of this stuff, I have to tell you. But maybe their heart was in it. Or everything else. Okay, you told me that the pictures aren't very good.
What I mean is that what I have seen, and I think what a lot of people have seen, is the loss of narrative in
story.
Film. Loss of story, loss of the ability to tell a story.
The kids that are out of film school who are, I find, that aren't inspired, of course, draw on old movies. That's the core.
Yes.
But the question is, how do they treat the old subject when they impose their values or lack of values? And we chose for you a comparison of the two Robin Hoods from 38 to, what would it be,
90, 91.
Yeah, okay, so you got 50 years in here. Here's Errol Flynn.
Hey there, pretty fella. Play a livelier tune that I can make this puny rascal dance to.
You need a merrier tune? Well, how's this? Watch, you've come to the right man.
My friend, I should ask payment for what I'm teaching you here today.
There's something on account.
There's your change.
Now that encounter is repeated in the new one, huh?
Yes.
Okay. Here's the new picture.
Swimming time again, old chum.
It's a blooming shame. He was a brave lad. Help! I can't bloody swim.
You yield?
Yes!
He didn't take it as well as Errol Flynn.
No.
Tell me what that means.
Well, it means, first of all, that he wasn't fair, really, about it. He lost the fight. And it means that the point of the first one is lost, which is that the strongest man is not necessarily the man that you want to follow. I mean, Robin Hood is a sort of blue-collar King Arthur. Loses to Lancelot, but Lancelot follows him. It's sort of a basic piece of folklore that says that it probably gave rise to the Magna Carta and the Declaration of Independence, which says that you don't follow men because they can subjugate you. You follow men because you feel that they're going to be best for all men.
We were talking about the Declaration of Independence backstage, Bob and I, or before the show, and Gene McCarthy once said when the federal election law was passed, he says, "To this dream of freedom, we pledge our lives, our sacred honor, and up to $100. Putting in modern terms, let's take a look at a favorite of yours, Sergeant York.
What I feel I should say, I imagine most everybody knows this, but York was probably the greatest, most decorated hero in World War I. He was a conscientious objector, and it was well known. And yet, when push came to shove, he finally decided to fight. He went and I think in the course of battle killed 134 or 138 of the enemy, knocked out several machine guns, won the Croix de Guerre, won the Medal of Honor, had the national parade down Fifth Avenue, a holiday declared by Congress, and is getting ready to go home here, and Cordell Hull is speaking to him about what is being offered to him as a result of his
heroism. Did you say he was a conscientious objector?
Oh, he was.
Go.
Are they offering that money because of what happened over there?
Well,
that's it, ain't it?
That's it. Take all the time you want to think it over.
I've done thought it over, Mr. Hull. I ain't proud of what happened over there. What we done in France was something we had to do. Some fellas done it, ain't a coming back. So the way I figure, things like that ain't for buying and selling. So I reckon I'll have to refuse them. Would you be a-telling them that for me, please? And tell them I'm a-going home?
Well, it's amazing always to me to watch that piece of film because of the conviction in it. And I remember seeing it as a kid and thinking, being happy that he did it, but not being overwhelmed with shock that he did it. That the notion that, some things were not for buying and selling was a commonly shared notion by everybody. But just as a pragmatic issue, it's just a lot easier to write well when everybody has a common language, and that common language is very often common conviction, because as you just got through pointing out, what happens is that conviction gradually disintegrates. I mean, you could you could see it in the 50s in, James Dean, where he was rebelling against the disparity between an order that he approved of and an order that didn't do what it said it would do. And he wasn't really a rebel, he was a reformer. In the 60s, that took the form of all-out rebellion against the established order, and you sort of threw out the values with the establishment, which now makes us sad. And then in the and then you get to superhuman figures that have no values other than winning at all costs, which is what
temporary
happens.
Financial advantage. I might add as we go, you know, when he says some things aren't for buying and selling, when Ivan Boesky got out of jail in the Milken affair, his wife looked at the moon as he was ruminating about putting his fortune back together, and she said, "Look how beautiful the moon is, Ivan." And he's reputed to have answered, "The moon, what good is it? You can't buy it and you can't sell it." So we lost some values. We may have lost ourselves along the way. Thanks a lot, Bob. Thank you very much. Thanks, everybody. We'll be right back. Give you a preview of our January show. In the January show, I'm going to review in detail Oliver Stone's movie JFK, which is being released December 20th by Warner Brothers. As some of you know, that I was on the staff of the district attorney in New Orleans for 5 years, so I have a little bit of familiarity with that case. And as you know, when President Kennedy died, somebody, a bunch of Democrats were together in New York, and one of them said, "Will we ever laugh again?" And Senator Moynihan said, "Oh yeah, we'll laugh again, but we'll never be young again." And I want to take you, I want to take you back to that time, and I want to encourage you all in the meantime till I see you. You know, we've tried everything else. We've tried materialism, and it would be great if it works, but it doesn't work. That's what I often say to young people. They, when I talk at a school, they say, I say, "Any questions?" They say, "What's wrong with drugs?" I said, "They don't work." You have to take a functional view with young people. You can't take a moral view because it's considered archaic. Morals are supposed to be an encumbrance, weigh you down so you can't fly, which is a proper figure of speech in this instance. So we've tried everything else, and I want to encourage you all to try your humanity. You may find that that's an untapped reserve. Now, in closing, I want to tell you one small story. You know, I was at a dinner with President Reagan for the opening of the library, which I worked. And after the dinner at the Century Plaza Hotel in Los Angeles, you know how people come up to the dais? So I was up there with President Reagan and Nancy and all. Donald Regan, the former chief of staff who was purged over the Iran-Contra case and found out he was fired on CNN. Nobody told him. You know, Reagan is not fond of confrontation. Except in the Cold War. So here comes Donald Regan, head of Merrill Lynch, a Marine major, 36 years in Wall Street, loaded for bear, angry, coming toward Ronald Reagan. And Reagan is amazingly diplomatic, very facile. Before Regan could say anything, and he hasn't seen him since he threw him over the side, President Reagan said, "Don." He said, "It's great to see you." He said, "I don't know if it's worth anything to you, but I'm sorry about the way it ended, and I want you to know I will always love you." And Regan was brought up short, and he looked at the president, and he looked at Nancy Reagan, and he said to the president, "If you love me, why did you marry her?" Good night, everybody. Thank you for coming. Thank you very much.
Thank you.